Good Friday morning, guys. My name is Jerry Miller, and welcome to Real Talk. This is an insider's guide to real estate, life, and the pursuit of happiness. Presented by the YES Team Realtors, trusted advisors in the game, Keith and Yona Smith. Honest, character, integrity, they embody all those qualities. Today's show, a good one, Jody Mills. Going to be our guest today, president of the Blue Ridge Home Builders Association, also very closely tied to what's happening at Derry Market and Derry Central, and frankly, the whole Stony Point Development Group.
She's instrumental to what they do there.
That very intelligent, very deep voice you heard right there is the distinguished gentleman, Keith Smith. Judah Wickhauer is our director. Well, welcome the distinguished gentleman to the show. Amigo, ¿qué pasa?
¿Qué pasa? The deepness is the fall allergy.
Right, so. Me too. I was literally talking about this with my wife. It's always the same time for me.
Oh, yeah.
You?
Well, actually, I'm a lot better than I used to be. I used to have allergies, you know, 24/7, 7 days a week, 365 days a year.
Claritin every day for you?
No, actually, I went to an allergist and took shots.
Really?
Not the ones that are over there, the ones in the arm.
And those are?
I swear to God, it worked.
It
went down to, man, I was allergic to everything, to basically just my seasonal fall, whatever the heck is going on out there right now.
Yeah.
Allergies. Yeah. Splitting headache all the time, you know.
Itchy eyes.
Yeah.
Stuffed up nose, scratchy throat.
That's it. Well, that was the bourbon last night.
Could have been that. Well, you know, anytime, especially now in this landscape, when you start feeling those symptoms, you're like, oh my gosh, it's the allergies.
So before we bring on Jody, she's a rock star, we're going to let her introduce herself and talk about the Prada Homes. And I'm just so thankful this was a last minute request and pivot. I know she's extremely busy to give us a few minutes of her time.
Jody Mills.
Oh, without doubt.
Jody. How about a little sing of her first name? Can you give me one? Jody.
Are you starting already?
Can you give me one?
I'm focusing.
I try to get you out of your shell and loose because you told me about the first 5 minutes of the show.
It takes about 5 or 10 minutes for me to loosen up a little bit.
Smith, did you?
Yes, I did.
Okay. Our chemistry's clicking.
Really? Is that what this is? For those who don't know, the moment I walk in, the first thing he says, Smith, hit the head. Because sometimes about an hour into it, I'm like, oh, geez, I wish I hit the head before we do that.
I love it. Well, give us, and Judah, if you could give me that silver Miller cup, if you could, give us a snapshot of why you like Jody, what your back and forth professionally, personally has been with her. She's amazing.
You know, the best thing I could say straight up, if you need something to get done, pick up the phone.
Get done gal.
She'll get it done, and do it in a super classy way, super thoughtful, and super engaging. I mean this. I'm not just saying this because everybody's watching here. Every time I have a conversation with her, I learn a little bit. Always learn a little bit, and then we have this kind of personal connection because her dad. My condolences go out to Jody. It's been a little over one year since the passing of her dad. Just want to let her know that she was on our thoughts and prayers a couple days ago. But, you know, her and I kind of come from the place of being children of firemen. So we have this understanding of what it's like to grow up in that environment. So I think we just click it off. At least I think I do. Maybe she might feel differently about that. But I'm going to stop babbling and we're going to let Jody chime in, Jody, because I promised her to get her out in a certain time for a meeting and we're 4 minutes over when we were supposed to call.
Got it. Jody Mills, we're calling you right now. We're excited to connect with you on the show. Live on Instagram, Facebook, across social media, we have Jody Mills on the line. Judah, give me a green light to welcome her to the broadcast. Jody, the hair is looking fantastic, Jody Mills.
And I was just about to say the same thing to you.
Oh my gosh, you look super beautiful. Hello.
Thank you.
Okay, Keith Smith says he needs to see Jody Mills too. All right, I'm going to turn it over.
I need a little love here. What about my hair?
She's making the set look great this morning. All right, Jody Mills, why don't you do an introduction for yourself personally? And then we'll talk shop professionally here with the distinguished gentleman, Keith Smith.
Well, thank you so much for having me on the show this morning. It's exciting. It's fall. It's crisp. Hey, buddy. How are you?
I'm doing great.
But it's fall, it's crisp, it's parade of homes time, so we're really super excited. So a little bit about me. So I wear a lot of hats. As you said, I was going to put my Blue Ridge Home Builders Association hat on this morning. So I am the president of our association for 2020. I also work for Stony Point Development Group. I'm the director of marketing and PR for the company, and we're excited about our dairy market project, which is opening later this fall. And I also am a local real estate agent with Nest Realty Group. So lots of different hats.
And an awesome mom.
Say that one more time.
And an awesome mom.
And an awesome mom, an awesome wife. I have a great family. Son who just got married last weekend in Stanton. So good times.
Oh, I did not know that.
I didn't know that either.
How did it go?
You're living the dream.
I am. And I get to spend the morning with you cool cats.
See, I told you she was good.
I love it. We should keep her around more often.
Well, she definitely increases the value of the set.
That's
for sure. Just a quick question. Who's actually next year's president?
It's actually Dirk Kema.
Okay, cool.
So you had him on, I think, a couple of weeks ago, if I'm not mistaken.
So we're talking Pray to Homes today, right? And thank you for doing this on such short notice. We got a little sidetracked on Tuesday's show, and I couldn't get to it. So you'll do a far more justice than I ever will. So tell us a little bit about what's happening this weekend. You know, the who, what, when, and where high level for the Pray to Homes. And thank you so much for your talking points. I love it when a guest sends us talking points beforehand. It makes my job so much easier.
Me too.
I did not wake up at 2:30 in the morning to do that. So thank you very much, Jody.
So I have to actually give props where props are like due. So Jenny Tapscott is our EO of the association. Big kudos to her. The Home Builders Association of Virginia just gave out awards a couple of weekends ago, and she was EO of the year for the state. So big thumbs up to Jenny. She deserves it so much. So talking points like that and everything that Jenny does for the association, we are so blessed to have her. So that's where all of that comes from. And, you know, just to kind of switch gears and go back to the question you asked, like talk about this year. So as we all know, COVID has really thrown a curveball into everything that we're doing. But when you're nimble and can pivot quickly, we said, what do we do to make sure Parade of Homes happens this year? Because there's a lot of places that said, no way, we're not going to host anything. So we decided before we knew whether the models could be open or not to go ahead and do virtual tours of each of the houses. So Airlands, which is a local company, went in and filmed all of our entries. And so they're virtual tours of every house so you can see them safely from your home. Or there's plenty of homes that are open for tours just like we always see them. And I looked at some stats, Keith, and, you know, Keith and I have done Parade of Homes for many years together. I've been doing this since 2010 and in Charlottesville. And we had over almost 400 people each day last week through homes that were open. So there's still people out there looking.
Well, that's a huge number, and thank you for throwing that out there. I've been doing them since 87,
And you're 39 years old.
And I'm 39 years old.
You've been doing it since...
Don't pay attention to him. But I want to go backwards for a second, just to talk about the class person Jody is.
Sure.
She gave a shout-out to Miss Tapscott. She's the one that did this, so it's a class person. She didn't need to do that, so thank you very much for doing that and shouting out to Miss Tapscott. So 400 people, what are we thinking this weekend? Think we're going to get good traffic this weekend?
So you know what? It remains to be seen. And Keith, as you know, typically on some of our beautiful weekends, people go in other directions. They'll go to the mountains or they'll look at leaves or what have you. So last weekend, the weather was beautiful and we had great numbers, or at least I felt like they were great numbers considering what we're going through. So it's hard to tell because it's a rainy weekend. So sometimes when it's a rainy weekend, you know, it's kind of a crapshoot. You know, sometimes on a rainy weekend, we get busier than we ever thought we would be. So I'm going to hope for the same thing, keep my fingers crossed that people will get out and take a look. Keith, I know you're going to ask me what, you know, what have we done to really set things up for success? And so we were lucky enough to have great sponsors. Our main sponsor for this year's parade is Nest Realty, but our two other large sponsors, Dominion and Guaranteed Rate, they went together. One did masks and one did hand sanitizers. And the models that are open limited the number of people they would let in at a time to come and tour. So between limited numbers, sanitizer, and masks, we're creating an environment that's safe. And so if you do want to come out and you do want to visit, there are precautions that are in place to make things people feel safer and feel good about coming through.
So these are the similar protocols we've set up for open houses. Yeah. It's basically just a huge open house with 400 people, which I happen to think is a huge number. So
that's an impressive number.
I think you're doing great.
Yeah.
But
so I'll give a plug. I mean, when I looked at the numbers that were coming through, some of the custom builders are really seeing the high numbers of traffic. RL Buyer, for example, saw some great numbers of traffic over in Ashcroft. And so, you know, when you have Dominion, which you have an intimate relationship with Don Kerber, he had great numbers with traffic last week. So custom builders are getting some good love, and I like that.
So what do you, I have an opinion why I think that is. Why do you think that is, Jody?
You know what? Because I think that they like to see things that are outside of the box. And I think oftentimes you'll see things that are a little out of the box with the custom builders. You know as well as I do, sometimes the larger lots, the trend is kind of going to that larger lot, that suburban feel. Both John and Ashcroft have those, you know, larger lots, the views, the privacy. Jerry, I know you moved into Glenmore a couple of months back, I guess in the spring. You know, you probably have a larger lot, and that's appreciated now in this time with COVID, a little extra elbow room. But that's not to say that the communities where we have, you know, small lot programs going on, that they're not getting love too. I found the numbers to be really, really high in some of those communities.
Yeah, so I we're going to talk a little bit later in the show why you should use a realtor in a transaction, a new construction. Go figure, it's a real estate show, right? Go figure. I want to go back a little bit to the virtual tour part of what you guys are doing. This is not the first year you've done this. You did this last year, if I remember correctly, right?
But not to this extreme.
Got it.
And truthfully, the benefit to the builder who entered in a home, and we did the virtual tours again for all, there's only a handful that only have virtual tours. Five of them, if I'm not mistaken, only entered in a home that's only available through a virtual tour. And what that means is that house was under construction. They, the builder and the people buying it agreed to say, hey, let's go ahead and do a virtual tour so people can see that type of home that that builder builds. It's not available today to walk through, but it's available for them to build in the future. And so that's why they went ahead and did that. So I think where it's different is every single home has a tour. Benefits are, we went ahead and opened up the website a couple of weeks ago. So if I'm not mistaken, we have about 3,500 hits on the website for the Parade of Homes. And people have been spending on average about 5 minutes to 10 minutes on the website. So they're spending a good amount of time. Yeah, the stats are fantastic. But the benefit for the builder who entered their home in is that we're going to keep that live for about 30 more days after the Parade of Homes. And then they get that virtual tour from Airlands. So it's a huge package and a benefit because it's available for an extended period of time. Even one of my colleagues who works with our company called me and said, hey, I saw the magazine, went on the website. Would love your help and assistance and possibly getting a builder to help me build a house in the future. So those are the types of calls you love to get.
So the specific reason why I brought it up was you guys, the Blue Ridge Home Builders Association was really in front of this. You've kind of started it last year, and we've been talking about this on the show, you know, virtual tours, or what's the new terminology that we...
It's a digital curb appeal.
Digital curb appeal, right?
This That's is what a, all my friends, well, let's cut to the chase.
And all your wife's friends.
Shots. All my wife and all her friends.
You don't have any friends,
right? And they're influencing us, yeah. All my friends are degenerates. My wife and her friends are good people, okay? They're Jody saying, oh my gosh, they're literally using this term. I heard it for the first time, what was like 3 weeks ago?
Oh yeah,
we talked about it.
We've been kicking around for a couple of weeks.
The digital curb appeal. How's the digital curb appeal of the home? And they're passing their phones back and forth, or they're airdropping photos from the listing, and they're like, oh, we need to go see this one.
That's exactly right.
And it's really influencing how they're going. I mean, this is the, I mean, I don't want to date my wife here, but this is like the 38 and under crowd that's using that term relentlessly, Keith.
Well, and as you know, National Association of Realtors has now said, and I think this probably is the same now with new construction, you know, there's three digital curbside tours, digital tours done before they actually go and actually see a house. So I just wanted to give kudos to you guys. You were way in front of it. You know, you had the basic systems and you just, you know, you ramped it up and really put on an excellent program. If the folks are watching, you know, we'll drop in the links in the feeds. You know, get out there, take a look at the homes. If you can't do that, the digital tours are unbelievable.
Jody, this question for you. How about COVID and custom home building? I mean, you talk about lighting a fire under an already strong industry. Custom home building and new construction exploding with the influence of COVID. Can you put that in perspective for us?
Absolutely. And, you know, you have a couple of things working in the favor of new construction. Number one, you have pent-up demand. You have low inventory as far as resales. You guys talk about this every week. You guys have been talking about it for a couple of months, certainly since COVID started. And new construction has taken off like wildfire. Now, all that being said, part of the beauty about being an association, part of the beauty of having support from the National Association of Home Builders is that we stayed an essential industry and we kept people working. And, you know, every single builder that I've talked to, my company as well, we have done and followed the protocol for COVID all the way through. So you have low interest rates, you have an essential industry, you have people who... you know, you talk a lot about that K economy, that upper portion of the economy that still wants to buy and has the means to buy, has their, you know, stability in their jobs, and they want to, you know, do something with their money. The stock market is still performing well. There's just so many factors that have supported the home building industry and, you know, people who want to buy a house. So the things that we're struggling with and we will continue to struggle with for the next couple of months are lumber costs, which have changed the average price of a house. We had a CAR session with the YPN group this week, and Frank Bailiff from Southern Development Homes was sharing that on average, he's seen about a 10% or a $10,000 increase on the cost of his homes. And, you know, that's tough. That's tough for the consumer because that gets absorbed by the consumer when they're buying the house. So there's some factors that we're going to have to work through, shortage of supplies in terms of appliances and some lighting. But that's nothing new. But the market is the best that it's been since 2006.
I echo every sentiment that Jody just said. You know, the question I want to kind of go to is back to this 400 folks and COVID. We're finding on our public open houses, people are super receptive to the protocols, right? That there's negative pushback. Everybody is thankful. So we do it a little differently. We only let one buying couple at a time in the house, and the other couple, if it's more than one, have to wait. Wait in there.
You send them a text?
That's exactly what happens. You know, we say, hey, you know, if you want to go for a walk or go grab a cup of coffee, we'll text you. It's been zero impact. Are you guys experiencing the same thing?
But how lucky are we, Keith?
Yeah.
Like, seriously, how lucky are we that you know, number one, that we have people who want to continue to see the house this. Sure. Number two, that they're being agreeable to staying outside the door and waiting for a text, but that they're interested still. Instead of everybody just staying behind closed doors, they're willing to cooperate and play the game the way they're supposed to and be safe. So my understanding from all of the builders that we talked to, the Parade of Homes Committee, is that they would limit the number of people and that, you know, there would be somebody monitoring how many people were in the house per time, that you would practice social distancing. And these are all the things that these local builders and builders across the United States have been doing, from what I understand, for several months now. They did close down operations for a long period of time, but when they, you know, started allowing people back in, it was with this monitoring and not just a free-for-all. And so I definitely don't want to send the message that it's a free-for-all and, no, you know, all these people are coming through the houses. It is an organized fashion and a system to make sure that people are being smart.
Thank you. You said it far better than I did. That's exactly the point I was trying to get across, is that the folks that are coming out to look at public open houses or the Parade of Homes feel very comfortable. So a great response to that. So we got about a couple few more minutes left, and I promised I'd get you off at 10:40, so we're a little over. So don't look at the clock. What else would you like to share with us? I mean, we've got a ton of people watching.
Yeah, I got some questions for it too.
Oh, great. So we got some questions, so we'll bounce some questions off of it. If we don't get to see each other again before he turns the laptop around, thank you for doing this. I know you're extremely busy, and I believe we have a meeting later on today, you and I, don't we?
I'm going to meet you at the dairy market a little bit later today.
I can't.
That got him all excited.
So this came up last night. I was having a couple adult beverages with one of our esteemed planning commissioners from Albemarle County yesterday. Uh-huh. And I was relaying to him that we have a ridiculous pinch in inventory, and it's causing prices for homes to skyrocket year over year. I learned from you.
Yeah, no doubt.
And he said, well, in a nutshell, get ready for more of this, because not much is going to change. So my question for you, Jody, is how do you characterize this market from a buyer-seller standpoint? And the second part of the question is, how do you see it coming into the 2021, into next year? Are things going to change? I mean, if we don't get any more inventory here, I just see this place getting more and more expensive. Is that a bad read, Jody?
You know what? I don't think it's a bad read, but, you know, definitely I will tell you this. And especially, you probably already know this if you're having adult cocktails with planning folks, is that one of the things, and I brought this up before, is our regulatory, this is not just Albemarle County, it's not the city of Charlottesville, it's a rampant. Our regulatory numbers and things that builders have to do in order to get, number one, developments through, houses and permitting done, those fees are really, really super, super high. And so they take, Frank and I were talking about this the other day as well, I think on average it's about 23% of the cost of the home goes towards those regulatory fees. So inevitably what continues to happen is the land values go up. All of these costs, the builders don't absorb those costs. They all go to the consumer. And that's going to make it tough, Jerry. And I don't see that changing. I don't see any of these regulatory strong arms and things that we're doing, I don't see any of that changing. And so I think that's going to be tough. You also have, cost of goods is going to continue to go up. So when you ask me about 2021, I would tell you, if you are on the fence right now and you're thinking of buying a home, and I think I said it the last time I was on the show, make the decision now.
Sure.
Get out and Parade of Homes, see the houses, determine where you want to live, determine what's important to you, put a dollar value to that, continue to look at your budget. But that budget today, if you wait, you won't have the same opportunities to buy next year. That number will look different and you'll have to adjust those things. So if you're someone who is flexible, great, wait until next year. But if you're somebody who's not and you want what you want and you have a dollar value set, buy today.
So we talk about this all the time. there's a lack of inventory, not from resale. There's a lack of inventory from lots.
And from land.
From land.
Yeah.
And the one thing that Jody is also talking about is the cost of time. So that 23% is probably hard cost. It doesn't calculate the cost of time that instead of taking 12 months to get a project approved.
That's opportunity cost.
That's exactly right. It takes 6 years.
Do you know what, Keith? You're right. You're spot on. Because, you know, if you think about the amount of time that people spend thinking about buying a home, and the amount of time they process that whole job of buying a home, once you make that decision, once you've moved forward, you contract for a house, gosh, imagine how much time you now save. You get that time back. You get to use it in other
That's
fashions,
exactly right.
Whether it's out, you know, hiking, whether it's spending time with family, whatever it might do. We have always said, we as salespeople, as builders, as agents, we can do a couple of things for you. We can save you time. In a lot of cases, we can save you money, right? And oftentimes we can help you gain a peace of mind in terms of that process, in terms of that buying process. Those are considerable things that we can give you as agents and builder representatives.
So clearly you were looking at my notes somehow from the second
Jody,
part of the show.
Point, Jody.
Second part
up,
of the show. I'll just get away and let you handle why a realtor is needed for a new construction transaction.
I'm going to ask her the toughest question we've asked her yet. Okay. Are you ready for this, Jody?
What am I drinking tonight?
No, Jody Mills. You made our director just laugh right there, Jody. All right, here's a tough question for you. Seriously. How do you think the election is going to influence the housing market?
So just like anything, any other election year, you're going to have stock markets that are going to react. I think regardless of what the decision is going to be, you're going to have fallout. Unfortunately, or however anybody looks at it, who knows how long it's going to take until we have an actual decision based upon the voting and what we're kind of looking at. So I think that you're going to see some topsy-turvy time for maybe 3 or 4 weeks. And then I think things will settle back down and it'll go back into its normal, kind of status quo. But it'll be interesting, definitely. But you know what? I'm a positive person. I look for positive things to happen regardless. We'll all adjust and we'll make do. And I think collectively, if we use our advocacies like we do our PACs, you know, both from a Realtor Association and, the Builders Association, we will always muddle through.
So spot on answer.
Yeah.
I think statistically, if you take a look at it, because we've been talking about this and looking at this, Jody, spot on. You're going to, historically, you see kind of a November, December, January is kind of leveling off. Everybody's trying to figure this out. This is a unique year for multiple reasons,
right?
Very unique. But I think, and then typically if you watch the data, which I've been digging into, then you get your January, February upswing because all this demand is realized, well, the world didn't end, right? Jody, Keith, and Jerry are having a conversation.
Interest rates are still phenomenal.
So that's the
and
one thing we.
Yeah.
And I'll ask Jody this. I have been doing this for several decades, 3 decades. I've never, ever, ever, ever heard of the Fed saying, we're going to keep it this way to 2023.
That's amazing.
I don't quite know how they're going to do that, but that's a whole different issue. But so if the interest rates stay the way they are.
I just locked in 2.65 off of 4. I got 4 in March. I was like, I'm winning at 4 in March and just got a 2.65. That is ridiculous.
It's insane. So I've been selling. I mean, Keith's been selling a little bit longer than I have and certainly been in the construction industry a little bit longer. But I've been doing
this
since
1997.
Say that one more time.
It's okay. Don't worry about it. Stupid.
I said I've been doing this since 1997. So I've seen interest rates in my time as high as around 13%. You talk about creative financing. We used to put together some pretty crazy programs. And that's not the highest it ever was. But that was what the highest it was since my tenure in the industry. To have interest rates at where they are today, boy, it's crazy.
I started at 18%.
Yeah, your first house was 18%.
Yeah.
That's a credit card.
But look, I think it's going to stay, you know, all the smart people are saying that, right? It's going to stay stable. But you remember this, Jody, better than most, is this downturn, this depression we went through, this real estate depression. We're not going to go back there because all the systems are in place now to prevent that from happening that were not happening back at the time.
And I was in Charlotte at the time. Yeah. And in Charlotte, we had the second largest banking capital in the United States. It tanked. And when NASCAR tanks, you know things are bad. NASCAR was not performing. The housing market wasn't performing. The recession was crazy. It was insane. But we don't have that.
No, so I talk about this. My analogy on that, it was like back prior to that, there was this cookie jar, right? And the federal government, the regulators opened the top and said, okay, you can take cookies out, and never really watched anybody. And the cookies started going up. And the next thing you know, the cookie jar was empty. And then, as the federal government tends to do, it shut it and locked it and said, well, nobody's getting a cookie now. And we've kind of worked our way through that. And we've had this discussion before, particularly, you know, Jody's National Home Builders at Associations at President on, excuse me, President's hat on, I'll get this out. We were building at that point 2 million units a year. And it took like 10 years to get up to what, 1.2, 1.3, whatever we are now. There was multiple years of 400, 500 units per year being produced. And there's so much pent-up demand. I think Jody's spot on. I think whatever happens in the election, there'll be this little blip, and then we'll get back to rocking and rolling.
We got to get this lady out of here.
Oh, sorry.
But we would not be doing our jobs if we didn't ask you about Dairy Market and Dairy Central. We cannot wait. I mean, you just announced the Milkman's Bar. I mean, the place is going to be, it's going to be the spot, Jody. Can you give us an update?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. It is the spot. And I can't be more excited if I tried about this wonderful endeavor that we're taking, opening up. So I just a little sneak preview, I would say beginning of December is our time frame for opening. So stick that in the back of your cap and keep it there. So sometime around that first part of December, we'll open the doors. We have a lot of great things planned. We're getting ready the week of the 17th to announce probably 5 new merchants. Every single stall in the Dairy Market actually has a lease on it. The leases are all out, all accounted for. We're just waiting for a couple of final details to come in. So when we open, we'll probably have maybe 6 or 7 of our merchants that'll be open at that time. And so it won't be like this grand opening, Jerry, but it'll be a soft opening. And then come March, when the end cap restaurant, so you'll have Star Hill on one side, another end cap restaurant on the other side, and then all the stalls in between in the main grand hallway. By the end of March, I would kind of predict that you'll have maybe 90% to close to 100% of the stalls open. So it is going to be a fabulous spring at Dairy Market.
Yeah.
Our chemistry, Keith, are you going to ask it or am I going to ask it?
I am not going to ask it.
Okay, is she going to tell us who they are, Jody?
I'm not going to put Jody in there.
So you have a couple of things that we announced, moved through recently. The Milkman's Bar, I saw that you were talking to Will Ritchie.
Yep.
Fabulous team over at 10 Course Hospitality. You know, big shout out, quite frankly, to Johnny and Jenny at Talheimer. They've been killing it, getting, you know, these folks in there. But no, I'm not going to tell you anymore.
I knew that. He had to go there.
I had to.
I would not do that to you, Jody. I'm just excited.
Like a pro.
I'm excited about our meeting this afternoon because I'm hoping Milkman is open because I could nice martini in the afternoon would be very nice. Very nice. But yeah. I'm looking forward to it.
We got to get her out of here.
Well, before we do that, I want to give Jody and Stony Point some shout out. I sit on, I'm one of the stakeholders on the Albemarle County housing chapter that we're writing, and we had a work session at the board Thursday, I believe it was, or Wednesday, I can't remember the day. Your organization, what you guys are doing on Preston, got multiple shout outs. Doing it right, you know. Just everything that you guys are doing over there, you got multiple shout-outs from all the elected officials on that. So I just wanted to share that with you, share that with Chris, see if he can get you raise up a little bit. So
You know what? Thank you, Keith, for that. And I know you're trying to get me out of here, Jerry, but a big shout out to the you guys. You guys are doing a fabulous job with your outreach for the public and housing. And I had a fantastic, after that session, I had a fantastic conversation with John Sales and brought it up yesterday at our board meeting and exec for Blue Ridge Home Builders Association. And we're going to work to try to figure out, we're going to set up a little subcommittee and work and try to see if we can get you guys some manpower and John Sales some help over there.
Well, John's our rock star. He and I spent a little bit of time together out in Portland on this cohort we're part of, and he's going to do some great work. Jody, thanks. Appreciate it.
Bye, guys.
Jody, you're the best. Thank you. You have good a good one. Take care.
Bye.
She's fantastic.
Yeah, and it's never a bad conversation.
Right. So easy to chat with.
Never a bad conversation, but I knew she wasn't going to give anything up.
Oh,
you had to try.
She played it so well.
You had to try.
She played it so well. All right. How excited are you for Dairy Market? I'm so pumped.
You know,
and you're a foodie too.
Without a doubt. Without a doubt. I'm pumped about it. I know you've been focusing on a bunch of this stuff on your noon show, which my hat's off to you. You guys are tackling a good subject. I actually had that conversation when I was getting my coffee at Marie Beth this morning from Will over there. Wanted me to give you a shout out that, you know, to think you could just shut something down and open it up is unrealistic.
Unrealistic.
Well, they just don't understand.
Right.
Just don't understand. Yeah. But yeah, so I'm looking forward to it.
Want some props from the Home Builders Association?
Sure.
Christopher Bremmett, love that dude.
Yeah, he had the misfortune of talking to me earlier this morning.
Christopher, I can't wait to get you on the show, dude. The virtual format, he says, enabled us to enter a home that would not have otherwise worked. It was a phenomenal idea. Great segment. Thank you for the BRHBA love. Love when that dude watches the show. And Christopher, you're welcome anytime. Susan Steinmart.
Hey, Susan.
The tour is amazing. Way to pivot to a great format in spite of COVID-19 impacts. What's the word of 2020?
Pivot.
Pivot, right?
That's been kind of my word for 30 years plus. Pivot.
And certainly 2020. Christoph Renke. There were over 800 unique visitors to the virtual parade sites between October 1 and October 4th. Wow, 800 unique visitors.
Yeah, so explain that to people who don't understand which would be me, by the way.
This is what I do for a living, as with an owner of an advertising agency. So you have two different kinds of visitors to a website.
Okay.
You have absolute unique visitors.
So what does that mean?
An absolute unique visitor is someone that's visiting a website from an IP address that is new to the website.
Okay.
And then you have repeat visitors. So if Jerry on this Mac goes to the Yes Team Realtors for the first time, that's an absolute unique visitor.
Okay.
If Jerry on this Mac from this IP address goes back to the Yes Team Realtors website the next day, that's a visitor. Okay? So you want to count absolute unique visitors, repeat visitors, and time on site. Those are the three most important categories if you're running an analytics campaign on your branded website. Absolute unique visitors counts individual people unique that have come to the website. Visitors counts repeat IP addresses to the website. And time on site is a characterization of how sticky someone stays on a website. Now, absolute unique visitors can be somewhat, so Jerry can visit from this Mac and this unique IP address, and then I can also go from my phone your website.
That's a second.
So that counts as two absolute unique visitors, but it's still coming from Jerry.
One person.
There is where it's a little ambiguous,
but
those three metrics, absolute unique visitors, visitors, and time on site, the three most important for anybody with a branded business website.
Know what you just did?
What's that?
Remember, in most of the shows you say I educate.
I learned from you.
I've just learned from you. Yeah. I've never really understood what all those terminologies meant.
Those are the three on November 1. You will learn even more from me.
Yeah.
Okay? And why I say that is because Judah and I will on November 1 be doing a seminar for all those that want to know about web analytics.
Oh.
How's that?
Oh.
You and I.
Oh.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
What day is November 1?
What? Judah's like, he just said to me, we are?
Alfred, did you just get talked into doing something?
Oh. Talked into.
Like kind of walking
he says,
down.
This is every day.
Kind of like walking down the mall in Batman and Robin spandex suits.
Oh, yeah. Does he have his?
He doesn't. He's Alfred. All he has to do is get dressed up in the thing.
What is that over there?
That's
for Liza.
That's Liza. That's Liza.
You're such a good guy.
No. I didn't. He did that. I've got your suit coming in. So let's stay on this subject because maybe this is interesting to folks. I know it's interesting to me.
Sure.
So how do you determine that? How is that stuff determined? This unique. How does one do that?
Well, so the best way to do it is to connect Google Analytics to your website.
Okay, got it.
And if you connect Google Analytics to your website, you have this robust data platform that tracks inbound, outbound links, keywords that people are searching. For example.
Is that called SEO?
Search engine optimization.
Okay.
Here's a good example.
We're not getting to...
No, good example, and we can get to this.
Yeah, no.
John Kerber, Dominion Custom Homes, our client.
Okay.
We have taken them from page 12 on Google to the number one organic spot on Google when someone types in Charlottesville, Virginia custom home builders.
And it has to be all those words.
Or Charlottesville, VA custom home builder, Charlottesville custom home builder. The key, if you're in a business, is what is a prospective client going to type into Google to find you.
Got it.
And once you have analyzed the 3 to 6 words that someone's going to type in a search engine to find your business online, then you create a robust and strategic content marketing campaign that features that terminology. And then you know what happens?
I'm learning.
Make a hell of a lot of money.
Yeah.
You make a hell of a lot of money.
And how do you determine the time?
What do you mean?
The analytics determine
the time on site.
Yeah,
the analytics will straight up tell you this.
You know,
in
certain respects, it's kind of scary, to be honest with you.
I mean, it's scary because, frankly speaking, if I had nefarious intentions, I could manipulate this skill set that I've developed over 20 years and really do some scary shit to people.
Well,
but I do not do that.
As someone who spent a half a decade in the Soviet Union and had people listen to conversations, it kind of just gets a little chill up.
Oh
my
gosh, dude. I mean, if I really wanted to, but I don't. I don't.
Thank you for clarifying
that. Okay. I mean, you asked me.
No, I know we've had
Barbara
this.
Barbara says November 1 is Sunday. So, Judy, you're working on Sunday.
Oh. That was an Alfred raising the eyebrows, if I've ever seen that. Look on that. So any questions from the feed before we jump in?
Absolutely.
Cool.
Absolutely.
You want to tackle a couple of them?
Sure. I'm going to throw this to you from Chris. And he says, how are we possibly going to make the area more affordable if what you're saying, guys, about not having enough lots to develop is actually the case? Well, it actually is the case.
Yeah, unfortunately, it's the reality.
It's the land trust is how we're going to make it more affordable.
Well, correct. I mean, that's one path to that. And yes, absolutely. So what that does is it takes the land out of the out of the calculation, right? So what the hope is and what the game plan is, we would work with developers and builders and, you know, part of this new housing chapter and the strategy and policies and procedures for Albemarle County, there's going to have to be a percentage of affordable housing units that meet certain criteria, you know, somewhere between 60% and 80% area medium income. But where we step in, and right now we're trying to raise the capital to do this, where we step in is we remove the land from the equation from it. So, you know, if it's a $350,000, and I'm just using an example, if it's a $350,000 piece of property or home and the value of the land, let's say, is $100,000, right? We take out the $100,000 and the house gets sold for $250,000. So that's the basic analogy of it. And I believe you've got on your noon show somebody from the land trust coming on.
We do. We actually have Sarah Whitney
yep.
from Tiger Fuel Company,
yep.
who's a strong partner of the land trust.
They are. They're strong partners in it. We have tons of strong partners in it, and we're really excited about this future partnership with Piedmont Housing Alliance, or Piedmont Housing, actually.
Right. That actually came up yesterday in my conversation with the unnamed planning commissioner.
Yep.
Can we give a snapshot on the partnership? You've been talking about it for a little while.
Yeah, but we got to be a little careful with it because we're in the middle of negotiations. I can tell you that both boards, both entities, are trying to figure out a way to make this merger happen. And you and I are super positive people. Jody's a super positive person. We're confident we're going to get there. There's a little bit of the devils in the details we're hammering out, but with any luck. We should have it wrapped up, if not the end of this year, the beginning of next year. But the intent is to take our model, right, and merge it together with the Piedmont Housing model. Where the land trust needs some help, frankly, is in its fiscal capacity and its human resources capacity. Right, we're a working board. 2,800 hours of Nassau Street is a prime example of
2,800.
Yeah, of a working board. That's just for me, right? But we're going to move over there where they have access to certain forms of capital that we don't, and they clearly have some great resources and human resources on it. So the hope is to put it together, create a bit of a behemoth on this where we can then start going out and acquiring properties. I can't remember Matthew's last name. He watches the show all the time. An advocate of affordable housing.
Gillikin?
There you go.
Yeah, Matthew Gillikin, good friend of this program.
Thank you, thank you.
Nice.
Thank you, Alfred. Facebook messaged me early this morning, super excited and asking questions about this, and actually was throwing opportunities at us to go ahead and do it. So we're in, if somebody would write a couple of $1 million check for us, man, we'd be making all kinds of magic happen. But that's what we're trying to grow that capital footprint in that human resource footprint so we can go ahead and make some magic happen. You're smiling, so.
Oh, no, I'm smiling because I love what you guys are doing. Well, I mean, I honestly, and I was literally had this conversation again last night.
Yeah.
I cannot think of a more impactful or effective way to create any kind of affordability in this area than that model.
So at the same...
Because did you see the article in the Daily Progress this week about the proffered homes for affordability are being purchased by people that are nowhere near the AMI requirements? Did you see that?
I did. So this housing chapter, this housing policy for Albemarle County is attempting to rectify that. The problem is the existing proffer structure, and Greg Slater, who we can get on the show hopefully soon, he's a little busy, understands this and can articulate this better than anybody. But I'll give it a shot. So what happens with the proffered lots, there's a time frame, right? So what would happen is Jerry Miller would put a house out on the market, right? And if it's some cases it's 90 days, some cases it's whatever, but it's whatever the rules and regulations was at the time. And some of these lots have been in the pipeline for 10 years or more, right? And the problem is if it doesn't sell within that thing, it can go to market rate. So what this new chapter is trying to do is help change that. And that's where the land trust comes in. And at this particular board meeting, this work session, unbeknownst, they didn't know I was participating in it because I was blind watching it and participating in it. Every single one of the Board of Supervisors said, yeah, like the land trust. So we're having an impact. Let's see how it goes.
We're streaming to Instagram, guys. I Love Seville, the third largest Instagram behind UVA and City of Charlottesville. Question coming in on what we're exactly talking about right now. Jerry, I did read that article in the Daily Progress. It said half of proffered affordable homes in Albemarle have been bought by higher income earners. And I was going to ask Keith Smith why this is the case. Sounds like he just answered it. But if we're trying to create truly affordability in our community, how are we allowing folks that don't meet the requirement levels to purchase these homes?
So the problem is...
It's a good question.
It's a great question.
Yeah.
The problem is under the current program, it just goes away. It's a timed out kind of thing. The other issue is, you know, and Chris Henry, a shout out to him. He's on my regional housing partnership that I chair. So we are, and you're going to find out in November, we're going to be releasing this new website that the regional housing partnership is working on.
Affordable MLS, essentially.
In essence, it's an affordable MLS. So one of the problems, and Christopher, Chris is on this particular committee, and he's working his tail off to get there. One of the problems that the developers and builders have is they don't know where to market and sell these.
Of course.
Conversely, the buyer or the tenant doesn't know where to look. So the intent on this is to put those two together and to marriage those two thinking together in one platform, one MLS platform. And there's a whole bunch of education process has to go to get it out, which hopefully we'll be able to do on the show. But once it gets released and it starts going out, you know, the builder, the developer will be able to put it in the system, in the MLS system. And one of the builders and developers are saying, I don't know what to do with them. Right? We as real estate agents don't know what to do with them. So hopefully we'll get this resolved. I'm comfortable that we are.
Marie Bett,
yeah.
We'll give them some love. That's what's in your cup, my cup, one of the sponsors of the show.
Yeah, I had a wonderful chat with Will, thank God things are doing well. And he wanted to share thanks for pushing this rock uphill about the indoor dining.
Yeah. Roy Wheeler Realty Company, Interstate Pest and Service Companies, Charlottesville Settlement Company, Dairy Market, Scott Morris, Pearl Certification, the who's who of the housing supply chain.
You know, reach out if you have housing chain, supply chain is absolutely the perfect terminology. Reach out, guys. They're rock stars. They will help you. They will move on. And I'm super grateful and super thankful that they believe in me enough to sponsor. So please support them.
Follow up coming in via Instagram on 2021 and our crystal ball. That's what they're asking. I mean, you're much smarter than I am. I learn from you constantly.
Well, no. On this real estate stuff, I just learned. I just got an MBA in SEO.
I mean, analytics. Of
analytics.
Yeah. Essentially, tracking the traffic flow of a website.
Yeah,
I mean, it's like traffic patterns on a Roam, but of a website.
I can tell you, I've asked multiple people to explain that to me, and that's the first time. Maybe our chemistry is such, but that's the first time it's ever been explained to me that the light bulb went on. I went, "Oh, now I get it."
A lot of times, and you know this, with what you do on the supply chain, a really good loan officer or a mortgage broker
absolutely
is able to present the information that's to
exactly
someone
right.
in approachable fashion. The ones that come.
Well, that's
in,
what we do.
And that's what you guys do.
So to pivot back into real estate and realtors and why you want to use a real estate agent and a realtor.
You explain. Like a human.
You explain.
Yeah, right. It's like when you go to the doctor's office and you get a fabulous physician's assistant or a nurse practitioner. Oftentimes the PA or the nurse practitioner can explain stuff to you that perhaps the doctor cannot or does not have the time to do. It's all about doing an approachable. So this question's coming in via the Instagram, and we're taking off here on this. So it's 2020.
We're not going to get to this again.
I mean, do you want to? Should we get?
No. Let's do this.
They're asking 2021. You guys, if you could give us more perspective of why you think it's going to be a strong year on Instagram. I mean, you got the interest rates. You got the people sprinting from the big cities in the densely populated areas like Northern Virginia to Charlottesville. We're seeing that constantly. I mean, it's going to be, I think 2021 is going to be gangbusters.
Gangbusters is how do you define that? It's not going to go backwards. We're not going to have we might have a lull, right? We talked about this. I think historically you'll see a low somewhere in November and December. Personally, I don't think that's about the election. I think that's about inventory. You know, we've had this, you asked me before we came on the show, how's business? Business is great. I just need inventory.
You've had the best year in company history.
We did, yeah.
And the year's not over.
The year's not over, yeah.
Is that fair?
That is fair.
Okay.
And we're super thankful and humbled by it. But, so I'll put my builder, I'm going to try a different analogy to this. I'm going to put my builder hat on.
How do you do analogies? My favorite one was the battleship analogy.
It was the aircraft carrier.
Oh, aircraft carrier. That one was darn good.
That was big.
Yeah.
So, but I'm going to use it again.
Okay. Oh, you're going to do that one.
You want to just do the show? Now I got to use a different one.
No, do it. It's a really
Miller,
good one.
No, I got to use a different one. So I'll use that one and pivot to something else that just popped in my head.
Okay, okay.
So it's a battleship. I like aircraft carrier because they're bigger.
Okay.
Right? So when you take that aircraft carrier and it's cruising at full throttle and you put it in neutral, it takes miles for it to stop. So that's how this housing market is, right? It is moving. Now, unless, God forbid, it gets sunk or something tragic happens, it takes miles for that aircraft carrier to stop. It also takes miles for it to turn. Now, if I'm in a 20-foot center console fishing boat and I'm at full throttle and I put it to neutral, it stops pretty quickly. It's easy to turn, it's easy to handle, and easy to do it. But what the analogy that I was just thinking about the housing market, so let's think about, I'm going to put my builder hat on. Let's think about building a house, right? We got building blocks. We're going to build a house. The foundation is super solid. So everything that has to go into, you know, as the foundation goes, the rest of the house goes. So if somebody like Christopher is still watching,
yes,
right, if you don't get that foundation square, you don't get that foundation level, if you just don't go ahead and get all that right and dead on, you're going to be fighting that all the way through. It's just never going to go right all the way up. You're building a multi-story structure. Derry Martin and Josh Batman, who's a rock star that works for them, they're building this apartment complex behind the Derry Market, right? If you don't get that parking, that foundation structure right, as you start going up in floors, it just gets worse. The foundation, the core foundation of the housing market is solid. It's square. It's level. So it's just going to keep on going. It may, instead of being a two-story house, it may be a one-story. We might, you know, the market might do a little bit of this. But at the end of the day, the foundation is there. What happened in 2008 and 2009, that foundation was sitting on soft soil, right? You dig your footers. Before you pour your concrete, you go get your compaction done, make sure it's on solid.
Swell.
It's whatever it is. It's on solid ground. If it's not on solid ground, then you fix the solid ground, which you can do, and then you start building on top of that. If it's not square, you're going to have a problem. If it's not level, you're going to have a problem on all that stuff. So the foundational core structures of the housing market at the moment is spot on. Now, if a bulldozer comes in and knocks a foundation down, then we got a problem. But at the moment, there's nobody's seen a bulldozer out there. And I don't think the election is it, by the way.
No.
There's some other issues that we're going to start tackling in the next few weeks. We'll do a tease.
What my appetite?
No. It's specifically towards real estate agents.
I
got some more homework to do and research to do before I start.
Was that the tax?
From this morning.
That's a good topic.
Yes, I'm going to reach out to folks like Michael Guthrie and some of the other brokers out there to get their read on it before I open up my big mouth. But I'm excited about it.
Why don't we get to this stuff, Ron? We have plenty of time.
Excuse me for a second. Alfred, do we have plenty of time?
Go for it. He's very agreeable.
I love him, man.
He's a very agreeable person.
Yeah, he's just, I don't think he has, he could ever possibly say an unkind thing about anybody.
Only
ever.
Me.
Well, that's for a reason. Have you ever looked in the mirror?
I try not to.
Have you ever watched any of these shows?
I try not to. Even keeled temperament and demeanor.
Yeah. Well, he's the perfect person.
Yeah.
For what
to
he
my
does.
Craziness.
Yeah, and that's why you guys do so well.
Yeah, 8+ years in counting.
Which is much like my wife and I.
Yeah, exactly.
And
very similar.
As I met your lovely better half the other night.
On Tuesday at El Mirachi.
Man, I tell you what.
It was banging, right?
Dude, I went out to Spring Creek to check on a job. We're doing a...
You did a hell of a job out there, Chris Henry. Same with you, Johnny.
Yeah, they did some great work out there. And... it took us
expand that patio all the way out.
So let's pivot for a second.
Okay. Right? We're going to pivot.
2020. What the hell? What the hell? But you've been having this conversation on your noon show or your 12:30 show about what it takes to open up a restaurant.
Yeah.
So I was fortunate enough to help the fellas move out there and open up a facility out there.
Johnny and his brother.
Johnny and Steve.
Yeah.
Took us 3 years. Now, that was from a group
that already had a restaurant.
Had multiple restaurants.
Right. They knew what they were doing.
Knew exactly what they were doing. This wasn't Keith and Jerry and Judah going, hey, let's open up a restaurant.
Right.
Right? These were people that, and what beautiful families. I mean, just, I've been fortunate enough to get to know their families. Just hardworking, you know, just loving people. I love those guys. Love the whole family. Love their dad, too. The dad's unbelievable. So the point is it took 3 years to do this, to open this up. 2 years of that was raising the funds. 2 years of that was raising the fund. And Chris Henry, God love him, stuck with us side by side for 3 years to get there and open it up. But, you know, we've been so in the weeds trying to get this restaurant open and get it there and do it. I kept on asking the guys, okay, we still feel good about this. We still feel good about this. We still feel good about this. Because, and honestly, we and I have been talking about this for quite some time. I think Zion's Crossroads is
going to blow up.
Is the next Crozet.
Yeah.
And last night proved that.
Oh, yeah. Let them know. You texted me about this.
I went, absolutely. My mind.
We were talking about them on the I Love Seville Network. And the food is good. And the location's fantastic. And they have good drinks.
You know,
do you have those photos? You can give them some love and put them on screen? Of El Mirachi?
Jerry, I love you. I love you, man.
But you said the line was outside the door.
So I went to Spring Creek to check on a radon installation just to make sure everything was kosher. And I was about 6:30 at night. And I called up Yona and I said, hey, you know what? I'll pick up a couple of tacos and bring them home.
You really wanted to...
Maybe I might have wanted a margarita.
Have a beverage, maybe. Let's be honest.
So,
okay, we're going to show photos.
Thank you. My point is I couldn't get in the parking lot. I literally couldn't get in the parking lot. Oh wow! And I literally, that was from when we had dinner the other night. Yeah, wow.
Side by side, that was a good night.
That was a great night.
Yeah.
Great opportunity to see your wife and your beautiful son. So the, it was great news. You know, I texted him after I said, you know, I texted him one of our Batman and Robin things that says, you know, holy shit, Robin, right? And I texted him and he was like, whoa. And, you know, it's great news. But the brain damage, the time, the effort, the risk that these guys had to take.
Significant risk.
Yeah. To go out there and go ahead and do this. And I am so happy for them that it is doing well. Go out and visit them. Everybody I'm talking to are doing it. But, you know, to wrap it back to what the Charlottesville mayor is trying to say, you can just go start something up. It doesn't work that way.
Right. To paraphrase, her said, if your business fails, you can just go and start another one.
So we lost everything we had between 2008 and 2010.
So this puts it in perspective. You're going to put it in perspective.
Very perspective. Yeah. It's taken us 10, up until now, frankly, 10 years to recover from that, to rebuild from that. A lot of wonderful people. Michael Guthrie is one in particular that was part of this, that we could not have done it without him, right? You're part of this. Every one of our customers are part of this. Every one of our clients are part of this, you know, but it's also us. But the reality of it is it took that long just to think that you can just turn the switch on and off.
Yeah, it's a slap in the face.
It's just...
Not realistic. It's ridiculous. It's out of touch.
Well...
Lack of experience.
So I'm going to use this word, and it's not an offensive word.
Oh.
Because I'm going to use it in the true definition of it. It's just ignorance. They just don't know. Right? You just don't know. So hopefully they get a little learning. I just got a text here that I'm going to meet Mr. Lloyd at 12 o'clock.
Lloyd Snook.
Yep.
Nice.
So, from Susan.
Nice.
We're going to talk land trust. And
very nice.
And talk how we can improve stuff.
I think he is the key.
Oh, yeah. Sure.
On the current situation we have, is he not the key, do you think?
Well, they all are.
But I mean, open ear, willing to listen, a t- ton of experience running a law firm, you know?
So every one of the five individuals on the city council, every one of the six, I believe it's six, Albemarle County Board of
Supervisors. Ah, the mayor's watching right now.
Of this, of
just
the,
giving you a heads up.
That's okay.
Okay.
Hello, Mayor. How are you today? Yeah. Love to have a conversation with you anytime you're willing to. The six Albemarle County Board of Supervisors, six Flavanna County Board of Supervisors, Nelson, Green, and Louisa. It's just one vote, right? And but every other, Michael Payne, whoever, right? Heather Hill, Ned Galloway, he's the chair, or Ann Malik, all have the ability to have a conversation with the rest of their board members, the rest of their city council members, to help persuade or help have a discussion to move a topic one way or the other. You know, there's one individual, be it Lloyd, be it Ann Malik, be it Keith Smith, or be it whoever, can't make that decision. It requires two, in the city's case, two other votes. In Albemarle County, it requires a total of four. To go one way or the other.
3-3 split is a no.
3-3 split is a no. That's correct.
That's crazy.
Which I commend the city, by the way.
Of having an odd number.
Oh, without a doubt.
Right?
Smart move.
Yeah. How, and I, you know, I learned from you. I mean, whose crazy idea was it to have an even number?
So it depends on who you talk to, right? It depends on which side of the fence you land on. And even some folks that are supporting an even board, you know, it just makes the Lloyd's makes the two other board members or three other board members. You have to do your job. You've got to convince a fourth board member to vote with you. I mean, that's all this is. All this is ABC, always be closing, right? You're going to have to convince the other board members, other city council members, to go ahead and see a subject, whatever it may be, the same way as you, right? That's all that is. And it's salesmanship. It's interaction. I had a great conversation on the way in with my brother-in-law, James Watson. And we were talking about this, you know, he's chairing the...
Civilian Review Board.
That's exactly right. And I watched it virtually last night, and I gave him a bit of kudos because he's, in my opinion, I'm a little bit slighted because I love him.
Yeah, he's doing a fantastic job.
Love him with my heart, all my heart.
They've had a lot of turnover on that board, and he's doing a fantastic job.
He's doing a fantastic job. And one of the... I suggested to him, because what we do at the commission and a couple other boards that I sit on and or chair, particularly the commission, I encouraged him to think about doing a roundtable at the back end of the meetings, which we do on the commission, we do on the Regional Housing Partnership, the Land Trust, so forth and so on. And I find that it's a super useful tool because if Jerry has a different opinion on something and Keith does, then what happens as a chair, I just will go around and ask, right? Okay, Jerry, what's on your mind? What's going on in your jurisdiction? What's going on in your world? What your nonprofit, Habitat, Land Trust? And then you talk about it for a while, and then I would go to Judah. And Judah may interact with you, and we kind of let these conversations go on. And I found in the boards that I sit on that do that, most members can't wait to get to that part because that's where the two-way different thinking happens. So hopefully he adapts that program for that. I think he will.
Fantastic show, my friend.
Yeah, one of these days we'll get to...
Is that Tuesday?
Yeah, either that or maybe that other topic that I texted you. I don't know. That's going to be a rock. That's going to be a...
We get every agent in town watching.
We're going to get every agent in town watching that
Yeah. Could have a multiple broker set up, or we get a couple brokers on.
I would love to talk about that. We'll have to talk about that off air and before my 12 o'clock with Mr. Snook. But
right.
I don't know how we're going to do that, but we got to figure that one out. That's going to be a huge conversation.
Maybe do a little Guthrie.
Oh, totally.
And then another broker or two.
Yep.
10, 15 minutes each.
I'd love to figure out a way we can do it all at once. That's the tricky
part.
That's
a question for
Alfred.
Yeah.
I think Alfred's head's going to explode if I have a conversation with Alfred.
All right, so this is Real Talk. It's presented by the Yes Team Realtors. Guys, I cannot think of, and I know what his response is going to be to this, so I'm going to say it first. Trusted advisors in the game, I can't think of a better option than Keith and Yona Smith of the Yes Team Realtors. Honest, hardworking, integrity, They're just good people.
No.
Keith and Jonas Smith, the Yes Team Realtors. Tuesdays and Fridays from 10:15 to... Real Talk on the I Love Seville Network. My friend, thoroughly enjoy it. Hope you have a good weekend. Tuesday show, I think, is going to be one of the most well-watched shows if we go down that road.
Well, we're not there yet.
Okay.
We're not there yet. We might end up doing Why You Need a Real Estate Agent in New Construction that I've been trying to do for a couple of shows. So, okay. But look, folks, go out to the Pray to Homes either virtually or in person this weekend. Every single one of the builders, every single one of Jody's teams, everybody involved in it. Believe me, I've done at least 20 of them, if not more, in my career. They put their heart, sweat, soul into them. Go out and see it. Even if you're not in the market, we're going to go take a look at some stuff because we're going to renovate our kitchen.
Nice.
And update it.
Get some ideas.
Yeah, get some ideas. And you'll find when you walk in and say, hey, whoever's manning that, I'm not ready to buy, but I'm really interested in doing some renovation to my bathroom, they will engage with you. They will help you. And they will say, well, this is why we did this, and this is why we did that. So go out there, get a little bit of knowledge. You'll enjoy it.
Very nice.
I enjoy it even better by not being the one that's sitting there.
Right. Well, you're actually like going in and like
learning.
Enjoying.
Yeah, enjoying it.
Yeah, not working it.
For decades.
Well, enjoying for you is also working, but it's different when then you're not the guy sitting there. Is that safe?
Yes, dear.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, Smith.
And we didn't talk about we got to talk about the raising money, Batman and Robin suit, but we'll do that on Tuesday.
Yeah.
Walking down the mall.
Judah said to me the other day, are we really doing that?
I think we kind of said it in front of enough people.
Said that as well. He's like, oh my God, we are really doing that. Real Talk on the I Love Seville Network.
Thank you guys
for joining
Go
us.
Go out for the Pray to Homes.
Go
Please
out for
do
the
it.
Pray to Homes, guys. Have a good weekend. Take care. Nicely done.